Welcome to the Intentionists Podcast, where we explore the interplay between intuition, spiritual health, and everything in between. I'm your host, Hilary Zwallen.
And I'm Aimee Schreiber. Our intention is to create a dialogue that inspires you to consciously forge your path with curiosity and compassion for life and its mysteries.
Hello and welcome to our very first episode, where we'll give you guys the short who, what, and why of this podcast for those who are interested.
So what this podcast is about is this is really just a conversation exploring how spirituality intersects with everything else through the lens of ancient and modern mythology, interviews with people we admire, and our own experiences in everyday life.
Yes, and it should be noted too that this is like the third time that we've recorded the intro episode. I wanted to just, before we dive into exactly the why of our podcast, but to just kind of bring our listeners into the process that we started to look into this like a year ago. We started talking about this about a year ago. We started recording 6 months ago, and we've really gone through a personal evolution during that time. And I think that, you know, I just like to bring it up that sometimes that the timing of this kind of stuff is important. If you're looking at, you know, why are we starting this podcast? Well, we've kind of had this idea and it's been really materializing over time. So anyway, so the why is because it's fun first. And we're really, Aimee and I are really fascinated by these topics. And we were having these conversations anyway for like, what, the last three and a half years, just kind of like every time we get on the phone with each other. Yeah,
they really started. We both went through kind of a faith crisis at the same time. And so this is the kind of thing that I would have really found helpful and wanted to hear during that time. So that's another reason why we thought, well, we might as well put these conversations out there for anyone who may have been going through something similar.
Yes. And we'll go through this in a little more detail towards the end of the podcast. I think it's important for our listeners to understand that both of us were raised Mormon and we're no longer practicing Mormons anymore. And that is totally true, Aimee. I think, like I was just talking to you before we were recording, but I can like distinctly remember when I had made the final decision after years of meandering through my faith process in Mormonism and kind of panickingly looking through just trying to find material that would resonate with me while I was in such pain around leaving. So we'll get more into that when we get into our own personal stories. But yeah, this was really, this is something that we would have loved to have been able to access or at least hear conversations like this. Not that there aren't thoughtful conversations going on around Mormonism. There's really amazing, there's super amazing content out there around that. But it was really for the next step, like really exploring spirituality, an untethered spirituality, was really important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then another thing about this podcast is our hope for it is for whoever's listening, we hope that, to provide some more access points for understanding and connection, trying to understand your own beliefs and other people's beliefs in the context of this global society that we live in. It has a way of kind of changing things and bringing clarity and awareness to what you're doing and why you're doing it. Just to, like we say in our intro, you know, just promote curiosity and compassion for other people just by exploring widely, like what this means.
Right. I think that there's a lot of people out there trying to look on the bright side, and it feels like the drumbeat of negativity. It's real. There's difficult, really difficult things happening, and people are trying to make sense of. But we really want to carve out a little corner of the world where we can really discuss and come from a place of trying to really understand. I'm sorry, my voice is so deep. I don't usually sound this deep.
It's early for you.
It's super early in the morning right now. But yes, so for us to just hash out and come from a place of wanting to understand people through their belief systems rather than what's right, what's wrong, who's at fault, that sort of thing. And right. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, Amy.
Yeah, keeping that understanding, but also keeping that skepticism to where we can decide for ourselves, like, what is helpful? What might be helpful for me? What's not helpful, you know?
Right. And really choosing to like take what works for you and leave what doesn't. So we're hoping to present a lot of different stories and a lot of different ways of viewing life and perceptions of viewing life that could be helpful that you can either say, that really resonates with me. Awesome. Or, that's weird. No thanks. You know, I think right. At the end of the day, we're really hoping to connect with listeners who are cultivating deep critical thinking.
Right. Yeah. And also one more thing. Another big reason why I personally was really interested in doing this podcast is because my whole life, I've really struggled with sharing my true thoughts with other people because I just always wanted to be agreeable above all else. So this podcast for me is kind of an experiment in honest self-expression, as well as everything else we just said about that.
Absolutely. Yeah. And, you know, and I feel like I've always been kind of just a talker, you know, and I'm fairly open, but I've found that in this space, I've been a lot more tongue-tied and I've felt very isolated aside from you and a few others. Although I will say now my world's really been opening up and I feel like I've really been connecting with a lot of people who are on my same path. But in the beginning, I felt like this was an area that I was just kind of paralyzed in because I thought I don't want to, my community at the time was largely Mormon and I really didn't want to bring all of my negativity to their world. And I also was like, well, then where do I go and who do I connect with and who do I talk about these things to? I mean, if I hadn't had you and I don't know what I would have done. So yeah, so this is, it really has been for me, this kind of the same thing that it's been an evolution of like, how do I want to present, you know, how do I want to be able to, how can I speak about this honestly and what's really happening for me? And, yeah, so there's a personal component to that for sure. And just for everyone's reference, because I think we still have a very Mormon family who is super supportive and amazing. And I just want to make it really clear that this is not an anti-Mormon podcast. We just so happened to both be previous Mormons and we felt it to be very important for our listeners to really understand that we are speaking through the lens of having been Mormon and all that it means to be Mormon to no longer practicing Mormonism and that just, we couldn't go through and maybe we'll discuss at length and in the future, that process, and we will touch on it briefly in a little bit. So,
yeah, for now, we'll just give the short story of very long stories. Do you want to start talking about, kind of your background and what you're doing now, Hilary?
Sure. So I'll start just quickly with my upbringing. My parents, I was raised Mormon, but my parents got divorced when I was 7 and they both had very differing views around religion, but it was agreed that we would be raised Mormon. So I was raised Mormon. My mom was not a practicing Mormon. And I felt like that experience of trying to make sense of one parent being Mormon and hearing the things about being Mormon and then one parent not being Mormon and all of the, you know, I think this is goes with any culture, but like her not being in the in group created a lot of internal unrest with me growing up. And so I was always experiencing Mormonism through the lens of is she right or wrong? Am I right or wrong? Who's right or wrong? Mm-hmm. And, you know, when you're younger and your brain isn't as it's just not as developed, there's a lot more trying to make things black and white. And so that was always a source of pain in some ways. But I also really loved the Mormon church growing up. And I feel like it was a really healthy place for me to be during my youth. So my decline, I went to BYU. I got married in the temple. I met my husband. He was also Mormon for a long time. And we both come from pretty Mormon families. On my dad's side, it's like super pioneer Mormon people, right? It's longtime Mormons. It's a really proud heritage that my family holds. Mm-hmm. And so, however, my immediate Mormon family were all very liberal Mormons and incredibly open-minded. And so I always considered myself like, I'm the open-minded Mormon. And they still are that way, but we were still always a part of the group. Right. And very much followed the teachings and the lifestyle, aside from some swearing every once in a while. Right. But anyway, so my decline started after I got married, and it was just kind of a slow and steady drip of discontent with policies and, you know, I was a professional ballroom dancer for a long time, and I was around a lot of dancers who were gay and who I loved. And I just felt like it was really hard for me to draw a hard line on church policies around homosexuality when I knew and loved so many gay people. And they were, like, in my opinion, some of the best people I knew and the most loving and the most compassionate, and also tortured because of the, you know, the confines of the religion. And I just had a really hard time with Prop 8. And so after that, or Proposition 8 in California, after that, it was just, we moved a lot. There was just things started to, I just got really disenchanted with the experience of Mormonism over the years, but I never really thought I would leave. Anyway, I'm taking too much time on this, but I'll try to wrap this up here.
It's good stuff.
But bringing it up to actually leaving, I think both my husband and I started to embark on like a legitimate faith crisis. It was over 3 years ago. I don't know, about 3 years ago. And we just started to really feel like, at least socially, with the social policies, that it was really hard to align with the organization. And then we started to kind of dissect, like, our Sunday experience was really difficult. And then we really started searching, like, it started to, you know, kind of question everything, like doctrines, the patriarchal structure, you know, no women in leadership, in real leadership. I mean, there's women that are really society presidents and whatnot, but they always have to answer to a male steward. And just kind of like, it just started to fall apart from every angle. And it was really one of the most painful things I've ever experienced. And thankfully my husband was going through the same thing at the same time, or it would have been really hard, but I will
say
that
rare, I think. Like, that's one of the biggest issues that most people having a faith crisis in a religion like that have, like, that could have gone really bad, but you guys,
I know. Yeah. I mean, it was really lucky. In fact, he was the one at first that was like, I don't think I can do this anymore. And I was always kind of like complaining about it, but like, I never really thought I would actually go. And when he was like, I don't know if I can really do this, it really caused me to be like, oh, whoa. And then what are we going to do about our kids? And like, all I know is how to raise kids Mormon. Like, what am I going to do now? Like, this is crazy. And so it was really just making the decision to leave was one that felt inevitable and felt really necessary. Like, in my quietest moments, it felt like the right thing to do, but it was just one of the scariest things I've ever done. And just worrying about losing, and really you do lose your community, even though I feel like the Mormons that are in my life here in California and my family and my longtime friends, they've all been so wonderful and it hasn't been an issue. But mm-hmm. I think that there's still a missing, there's a huge missing when you leave that community. And so then that brings me to kind of, so what have I been doing the last 3 years? And I think part of this podcast, that, you know, with being ready is I think that I'm legitimately at a place in Mormonism where I feel like, in terms of my spiritual path, that I'm in a place where I can genuinely honor my Mormon background and really love it, because I've moved through the pain and the anger and the sadness. And I mean, it still comes up sometimes. I find I'm surprised when it pops up and creeps up when I'm sad about it. But it kind of feels like 3 years post-divorce, sitting with Mormonism church / ex-husband at the soccer game. And right. He's got a new girlfriend, and like, it's cool. Like, it's awkward, but it's cool. And we're there to support the kids. Like, I feel like I can kind of live in the space of Mormonism like that, that it's not, I'm not on a tirade to like, this isn't right for everyone. I feel like what my spiritual path has taught me more than anything is that Mormonism is absolutely right for so many people. It is the path. And I honor that in people who choose it. But it wasn't my path. And there's so many paths that's part of kind of what we're going to be exploring here. So in terms of where I'm at now, there were a few things that happened during that faith crisis time, but I felt like I had, in some way, a spiritual awakening. And I got really into the healing arts, and I'm currently in a shamanic training, and I was Reiki trained, and there's been a whole bunch of, tons of yoga has passed, lots of yoga and has been going on in my recent history. And I've been really wrestling with what to do with that, because I felt like I was put on this path. But where I came from, and I'm wondering if, should I go into this, Aimee, is just kind of my business story now, kind of that, is that what do you think?
Yes.
So about 5 years ago, I started a clothing company, and my kids were really little, and it was a really crazy time, and it really exploded. It was a clothing company called White Plum. And so I was really in my, there was a lot of creativity, but it was also a very left-brained experience where I was just like living in the moment and having to just deal with the breakdowns and the triumphs and just all that goes into running a business. And around the same time I was leaving Mormonism, we were in the process of selling our company. And so now, so we ended up selling our business to a fashion house, and let's see. Yeah. So now I've really just dedicated the last year and a half to contemplating different business ideas and really just reframing my brain, going on my own healing personal path with my body and with my heart and my soul and my mind. And so I'm still in a place right now where I'm unsure of how all of my spirituality based and energetic based studying will play into my day-to-day life. But it really felt like, for me, and knowing my own talents and my own interests, that this podcast was a perfect way to start to harness the knowledge and wisdom that I've gained through this experience. And I'll have a website up soon. Aimee's helping me with that. hilaryswallen.com. But in this moment, I'm just open, and I'm trying not to really define myself by what I've done in the past. And I know that kind of sounds nebulous, but in so many ways, it's part of my process has been shedding the identities that are associated with needing to have value in resume building situations,
right.
I'm important and I can be loved because I did this, and really challenging those beliefs. So,
well, that is the challenge of this whole process for you, is shedding the identity first of being Mormon, then of being a business owner, then like all these things. I think that's really one of the most important parts of my spiritual path too, is just understanding like, okay, who are we really? Like what matters, and like what parts of our identity are like hold us back when they're no longer valid. I think that's
Right. That's all of it. Right. And
that's the challenge.
Just for the record, for people that don't know us personally and that are listening to this, what Aimee and I became really close through White Plum. We worked together, and Aimee was a really awesome, amazing creative force at White Plum for a time. And it was really there where we fostered a friendship. And then it started to carry on outside of the business, outside of the workplace, where we would have these discussions. And we really like found each other and became super close, like at the moment of both of our, we were like just really deep in our faith crisis. And it was like, I remember standing in my backyard and like our kids are playing together. And it was kind of like, hey, so what are you thinking about this? And you were kind of like, I don't know. I'm kind of, you know, we were both kind slowly admitting to each other where we were at and kind of like, wait, you're thinking that too. Oh my gosh.
I know, that was like the best and most shocking day ever. We walked to the park and I was like in super deep depression because I think I had like just stopped going and you were like, I'm thinking we're not going to do this anymore. And I was like, I was so relieved and so happy to like find someone that I could talk about this stuff to, because it's hard to find people to relate. You know, I had my husband to talk about these things with, but he, having never been Mormon, it was like, it was harder to imagine, you know, what, like the actual undoing those inner workings.
And yeah.
It
was just such a gift. I mean, I think, and to have a close friend at that moment. So that's really where all of this has come from. And I think we've just kind of really helped each other along the path of deconstructing our identities around, you know, the collective Mormon, what was taught, you know, and then all while really trying to honor our families and their process and trying not to make our community completely wrong and going through the motions of anger and pain. And anyway, and what I found now that I've started to create community outside of Mormonism in my own life is so many people go through faith crises and it's, or faith crises.
I think so. Yeah.
It's early. But you get the point. I'm just surprised that it's so common, and it's, you know, so you just fill in the religion, Catholicism, Pentecostal, Judaism, whatever it is that you're leaving or coming to, just know that we're hoping to create a space for people that are in that searching and seeking curious place in their life. Mm-hmm. So Aimee, why don't you, is there anything else I'm missing that you can think of? I feel like I covered pretty much everything. It was longer than the short.
You did a good job.
Okay, I know, so Aimee, why don't we turn it over to you and tell us about what you're doing in Puerto Vallarta, Mexico.
Yes. So I am a digital nomad of sorts, and I'm currently working from Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, doing content marketing and graphic design. We moved here, my husband and son and I, in August after we had been living in Washington State and decided to sell our stuff and kind of challenge ourselves with a new experience and a new language. We've always kind of wanted to do this, and it was just time. And then I also just started a yoga teacher's training program on the weekends here. So I've been getting the full English, Spanish, Sanskrit experience in yoga here. So that's been really enjoying that. And I also create art and write in my free time. And so I've been working on some children's books. So you'll probably be hearing more about those later. But My educational background is in exercise science and psychology, also from BYU. So I'm really interested in just the relationship between the physical, psychological, and spiritual aspects of humans. So in our discussions that we have, we'll be coming at it kind of from those types of angles. And I have a website, namastemi.com. And you can find me on Instagram too. And all that stuff will be linked from our intentionists.com website. And so for my religious background, like Hilary said, I had actually a really great childhood. I was the second oldest in a big Mormon family and raised in Central California. And growing up, I didn't really realize it, but I kept myself pretty sheltered intellectually, and I never really questioned anything beyond that certain safe point that kept the entire belief system intact. I didn't question until I was a divorced 25-year-old and I was trying to convert my soon-to-be husband to my religion. And so, a long story short, I started reading a bunch of things like Joseph Campbell. I talked to Jehovah's Witnesses for hours and hours.
I remember that.
I remember
those discussions.
It was very therapeutic. But that was like for the first time I allowed myself to conduct these thought experiments where I tried to look at other people's beliefs and my own beliefs from different points of view. And so after really digging, and I was trying to place all these things like the origins of the Bible, the beginnings of the LDS church in their historical and cultural contexts, things started to like make a lot more sense, but it just wasn't in the way that I was hoping for.
Right. Like, it wasn't in the traditional narratives, right, that you were used to.
Right. And so I, ultimately, I realized I just no longer believed all these things that I'd taken literally my whole life. And even more than that, I felt that under the umbrella of my religion, or kind of at least how I was operating in it, I lacked the tools that I needed to explore and progress as a person. Like, I came to this point where I was really surprised and disturbed because I became aware of my own critical thinking deficiencies as I was trying to like stretch my brain and like exercise this kind of atrophied muscle. Cause I'd always thought of myself as this really thoughtful, authentic person who understood how to think things through, how to like objectively look at something. And I found that wasn't the case. Like until that moment, I had never even really tried it before. And so I actually took a test in high school that I remember that I would think about often during this time, because I was a really good test taker and I would always score really high on all these random standardized tests we had to take, except there was one section in one of them that measured critical thinking and I scored really low on it. And I was like baffled at the time, like what could have happened here? Like, how come I couldn't figure this part out? And so
that's interesting.
Anyways, yeah, just like that journey of kind of learning how to like examine something like from start to finish, that was kind of the first time I'd ever done that, which is, I don't know, maybe a little embarrassing to say. Like, I was a
no, I mean, it's a really interesting insight though to kind of like where this started from, you know, like right. That your brain had fused in a way, especially now that there's so much information on neuroplasticity and how we can really train our brains in certain ways that basically through cultural conditioning, there was like a whole part of your brain that hadn't developed in the way that the rest of you is so insanely intelligent, you know, because I know you and you're like one of the smartest people I know. So,
well, I mean, more than that, this is like for us, we were the pre-internet, like we were the last of the pre-internet, I think.
Raising it. Yeah, we were raised Mormons. In like, a place where, yeah, the internet was like my, yeah, I got email when I was about 17.
Right. Well, my younger brothers and sisters, all this information that I like was learning about, like they already had known all this stuff. They had the internet. They looked at this stuff when they were like 15 and were like decided what to do with it then. But it's like, this was the first time that I was like finding out about like more, like a brighter, a wider view of the background of Mormonism.
Right.
And so
that the stories didn't totally match up from what you were told to what was, you know, potentially reality.
Right. So, I mean, so during this time, like deviating from the expectations of my community, it was and continues to be like really vulnerable and uncharted and difficult. I think mm-hmm. reactions on both sides were mostly characterized by kind of shock and confusion, because it's like, here I was shocked and confused, like, wow, all these things I thought I don't think anymore, and what do I do about it? And then for my family, it was like, wow, all these things you thought you don't think anymore, and what do we do with this? How do we interface? But
well, and even just that thought of, like, I remember a conversation you and I had years ago that was like, when I decided to leave Mormonism, it was like, okay, now what? And then you kind of go to like questioning everything, and it's like, wait, so have I, if I'm not praying to like the friendly grandpa in the sky, then contemplating God in any other way is really kind of scary, because the contexts that you've known are very safe and familiar, and mm-hmm. and it starts to just unravel, like, you know, it's not a faith crisis for nothing, right?
Right. Yeah. I always think about it like I'm in this very small, pretty snow globe, you know, mm-hmm. as like within the Mormon church. And then I start digging around like underneath these little buildings of the pretty snow globe. And I'm like, wait, that doesn't look how I thought it looked. And then suddenly the whole thing shatters and you're like, everything's on the table at that point. Like there's this whole kind of void of mystery that you were sheltered from before. And it's exciting, but it's scary. You know, it's the unknown.
Right. And so and I do think too, I mean, I was always really curious about other religions and other, just other traditions and cultures. That was always really interesting to me, but I always looked at it through the lens of, I have the truth. And it's really interesting mm-hmm. that people believe that way, and always kind of viewing it as trying to be respectful, but still the other. And I think when you really take off the robe of all of your belief systems and you're standing there kind of figuratively naked and just kind of looking at like, well, what if all like, what is true then? It really, you know, I contemplated like, what is truth from my comfortable space? But then to really contemplate what mm-hmm. is truth once you've stepped away from it is a whole different, it really is it's a crisis, you know, it's a painful thing.
Yeah. They don't call it the crisis of faith for nothing.
Yes. So that's the lens we're coming from. Aimee, I didn't mean to cut you off. Is there anything else you wanted to say on that?
No, I was just going to say that, like, embarking on a path like this, as painful as it has been, I mean, it's been good and bad and, like, every emotion in between. But the important thing that I have realized about this is, like, that the path is my own path, you know, which is not, I couldn't say that for almost anything that I ever did before this, like, this path is coming from these like interesting, truer parts of me that I wasn't acquainted with before. And so like continuing on that journey toward authenticity and like being intentional with my life, it's harder because you have to put more thought into like making all your decisions. Like, but it has been one ultimately that has been rewarding in ways that I didn't know was possible before. And like, I think that's kind of the goal, like our continued goal with doing this is to continue to foster that type of curiosity and authenticity in ourselves.
Really. Well, and hopefully to just invite people to come along with us as we walk mm-hmm. with our little torches through the dark caves and wondering, you know, what's really right. going on here. And really too, I think 3 years into it, I mean, we've talked a lot about how difficult leaving our communities was and how hard and how it's really been a process that's come in layers. Like I'll think that I'm really cool with it, and then there'll be a trigger and I'll get upset or I'll be sad or whatever. But I will mm-hmm. say that, you know, 3 years out of it, that I'm in a space of really what I would consider to be in most days in the context of my spiritual path, I'm in a place of real magic and wonder, and I'm feeling so much love and and awareness and awakening from what I feel is the divine. And I'm feeling like I'm able to call in people in the weirdest ways to engage with me in this. And it's been, that part of it's been really fun and exciting, you know? So that's kind of where we want to shift the focus to in going forward in this podcast. And that's kind of the goals for the future for this. Right now we're looking at this podcast as just kind of its own living thing that will move forward however it wants to. And perhaps we'll, you know, I'm working on other businesses on the side. I'm getting some things started. I also do coaching and things occasionally. So the goals for this, for the future, we will keep you posted.
And, right. Yeah. I'm excited to see how this thing evolves and
right. You know,
what happens.
Do you want to talk about what our listeners can expect? Like what's coming up next for our next episode and our the series that we've got already recorded?
Sure. Yeah. So for our first series, we decided to tackle intuition and kind of what is it? How do we access it? And how is it talked about, you know? And so that's what you can look forward to for our first little actual discussion, non-background discussion. And then
we have a How to Be Your Own Healer series after that.
Yes.
And then we've got and we're doing, you know, interviews, conversation, storytelling, all different modes. So we're just going to let this happen. Like I said, we've been working on this for a year and we've recorded a lot of material and have been in that place of like, what does this want to be? How do we want to present this? And so I just like to bring that up so that for those of you that are wanting to start something. I've started successful ventures in the past. I've failed at a lot of things too. Mm-hmm. I just finally came to the place because I think this is such a raw and, you know, this is like the closest thing. I feel like people's relationship to God is about as special. Is that a word I want to use? You know, as sacred as you can go.
Yeah.
And so this one's taken, we haven't been just like marching our way through, but we're hoping that we're offering it up that the path will unfold as it needs to, and it may deviate from all things spiritual. Right now we're hoping to take a spiritual lens and hoping to understand different topics and people and cultures, and so that we can all hopefully live on this earth together in a way that is more harmonious. Hashtag world peace.
Well said.
Yes.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. Yes. So, I feel like that's where we're at. So,
yeah, I think that's a good little summary background. And I'm sure in the future we'll go way more into like, more about the journey out and like actual things that happen where we were able to pick ourselves up from, you know, go from crying on the floor to like happily dancing in the field, you know, like stuff like that. Like how is that possible? I don't know. Just kind of like what does it mean to be human on an evolving spiritual path?
Exactly. And things that I think too, like there's certain things that have brought me, like I got super into crystals. I'm still super into crystals, but I mean, I got super into crystals for a while and I was like, these make me so happy. And now I'm kind of like, I mean, you know, you evolve like some, I don't use them as much as I used to. I still use them, but it's like things, you know, what you're really into at one point, you can, it's a continual evolving path. And,
right.
And
the
yeah.
ongoing challenge of like, also not latching on to things that are approached in the same way we approached Mormonism originally. Do you know right. what I'm saying? Like trying to carry through the skepticism and the critical thinking to all these things that like excite or fascinate me has been like a huge challenge, which yeah, we'll talk about all that, but I don't know. I feel like we can wrap this up now.
So we'll see you guys in our intuition episode. Thanks for joining us.
Before we part, we'd like to say thanks for listening, and we hope you'll connect with us on Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube. We would love to hear from you and appreciate all feedback, shares, and likes.
To learn more and subscribe to our newsletter, visit intentionists.com. And no matter where you are or what you're creating, we send you love and invite you to breathe and begin.
See you next week.